I'm great, sir.
Okay.
Hello, James. How are you?
Hello, sir. I'm good, sir.
Your smile says everything good and you are happy.
Yes, sir.
So, James, you have been taking good care of yourself during these times.
Yes, sir. I have been taking good care of
You
myself.
are a biochemical engineering and biotechnology graduate.
Yes, sir.
So, you are keeping pace with what is happening in the field of pandemic and research that is going on.
Yes, sir. I have been keeping a track of things.
Okay. And you are from Delhi.
Yes, sir. I am from Delhi.
And then you did your graduation from IIT Delhi.
Yes, sir.
And you have worked in
Sir, I have not been
company.
working after my graduation. I have done an internship during my college for
Okay.
2 months.
This was in Nomura Research Institute.
Yes.
Now there are two kinds of researches that are going on these days. One is a conventional kind of research based on library studies, and second is a research which is based on internet. Now, since you have worked in a research organization, so let me begin by asking you the advantages of or disadvantages of both kinds of researches, that is based on the conventional methods of books, documents and literature, and second based research based on internet information, which you think is more reliable and secure.
Sir, I think that research should take benefits from both conventional as well as new age technologies such as internet. In the conventional research, the books are more reliable because they have been audited, they have been reviewed by the author and the publication. But in the new age internet tools, there is a lot of disinformation and fake news that is also available. It is open source. For example, Wikipedia, anybody from around the world can edit the information. And that can lead to wrong outcomes and wrong research facts in your research. So, sir, a prudent selection of the type of the sources that you are referring, even on the internet, that has to be done before taking out the facts.
And in case of pandemic and
Yes.
COVID-19, what is your assessment of a viable solution for the world? When you think vaccine will come out, when you think a medicine will be available to people, let's talk about India itself.
Yes, sir.
You know
Sir, a
which
lot.
companies are doing research and which companies have announced, including ICMR. So just tell us more about your knowledge on COVID-19.
Yes, sir. Sir, a lot of research has been happening for finding a vaccine, but a lot of research has also been going into developing medicines and therapeutics. For example, sir, Gilead Sciences has come out with remdesivir, which is proven to reduce the hospitalization by one third. There is another steroid called dexamethasone, which has also been approved for use to reduce the mortality rate, and it is very cheap and easily available. And thirdly, sir, there have been developments in plasma therapy, and Delhi has also recently opened a plasma bank in the Institute of Liver and Biliary Sciences in Delhi. And as far as the vaccine goes, sir, there have been good progress in phase 3 trials by institutes such as Oxford Institute in partnership with AstraZeneca. And companies such as Moderna and Pfizer have also proceeded to phase 3 clearances for their vaccine candidates. As far as India is concerned, sir, there has been a Covaxin candidate by Bharat Biotech Industry Limited. And a company called Zydus Cadila has also been given permission by DGCI for their phase 1 trials. Although, sir, the ICMR has set a very ambitious deadline of August 15 for release of the vaccine. But then, sir, we are having good progress, although we may not achieve a marketable vaccine by August 15.
Is there any other threat of any other pandemic from South Korea? There was a news item of yet another virus emerging which is deadlier than COVID-19. Any information with you?
Sir, I have less information about the South Korean virus, but there was emerging news of the G4 strain of a swine flu virus in China, and that has a pandemic potential.
Okay, in this whole episode, what is the role of WHO and how you rate it?
Sir, WHO is the only global body that is coordinating the research and the efforts of various countries and is a single point source of information exchange between different countries and coordinating efforts. However, sir, since the start of the pandemic, there have been shortcomings and inept handling of the coronavirus, starting from the origins and the information seeking from China about its human-to-human transmission, about the evidence that was emerging from Taiwan. And sir, WHO has also been accused by countries such as United States for parroting the line of the Chinese Communist Party. So, sir, on that front, it could have done much better. And sir, but given that the pandemic and the coronavirus is novel, and we still have a lot to understand about it, the WHO also took actions which fitted that situation.
Let's talk about biowarfare. What are UN charters on biowarfare? And do you think existing the pandemic is also part of a biowarfare?
Sir, under the UN, we have a Biological Weapons Convention, although it lacks the teeth for enforcement, but it has banned any kind of biological mass destruction agent to be stockpiled and used in any aggression or any armed scenario. Sir, in terms of the coronavirus, I have limited information because even the WHO has initiated an investigation into the origins of the coronavirus and its response. So pending that, I cannot comment.
Okay, two more things. You are from Delhi, you are from IIT Delhi. So IIT Delhi has got a brand name, brand value, and so has got civil service. Which brand value would you rate as higher brand value, IIT versus civil service? Which is a higher brand? And have you selected the civil service only because of the brand value assigned to it?
Sir, both are very reputed in their own field. The civil services is known for the welfare of the society. And since the times of independence and even before it, it has been the steel frame of our government. And it has helped India do a very good journey and achieve a lot of things for our country. And in terms of academics and research and science, sir, IIT Delhi has been a formidable institution in that it has contributed to research papers and many new inventions. Even in the coronavirus, today is the release of a COVID test kit by IIT Delhi. It has a potential of 2 million tests per month and it will impact a lot. Sir, I have not personally chosen civil services for its brand value as such, but definitely for its reputation as an institution credited for India's growth journey. I have my aspirations and my passions, which I think will be fulfilled by this institution.
All right. Yesterday, CBSE results were declared.
Yes.
And Delhi achieved 98% success in the government schools. What do you rate based on this Delhi education model as the best model available for education anywhere else in India?
So the Delhi government schools have done a lot, and even in the last few years, their pass percentage levels have been increasing, has been on the rise and better than private education institutions. That is because of many good aspects of the Delhi education model, such as the increase in funding to almost 25% of the Delhi government 60,000 crore budget, and also missions such as Mission Bunyad and entrepreneurship curriculum. And so these are aspects that can be emulated. But every state has its own demographic and societal needs. And the education should be tailored to those particular circumstances, although certain good points of the Delhi education model can be replicated for sure.
Okay, last question before we move on is on the new financial year, second budget, and future financial planning in view of the COVID. What would you briefly recommend on all these three headings? Second budget, should we come out? New financial planning, is it required? And talking of a new financial year in view of 2020 being a very peculiar year. One sentence.
Sir. Yes, sir. So definitely we need new financial planning because of the emerging coronavirus scenario, which has dented the government revenues. And it has also led to our projections of the revenue estimates and the budget estimates being going haywire. And we need to set new fiscal deficit targets because the current deficit targets are not enough to allow government borrowings to tide over the revenue loss. And sir, as far as the budget is concerned, the government has announced a 20 lakh crore Atmanirbhar package and a number of reforms and initiatives under it. So it can be said that a new mini budget has already been launched by the government to tide over this crisis in the meantime.
And new fiscal year? Should we change fiscal year from April to March within bracket to a calendar year like rest of the world, most of the countries or the rest of the world? Will it help? How?
Sir, I think the current system has a certain linkages with how our economy functions because our agricultural kharif season and the rabi season are tailored to that April to March season. And at that time only we understand what type of kharif sowing has occurred in our economy and what kind of revenues we can expect and the industry can function. But sir, definitely if we can shift our fiscal year, it will align to the global benchmark and it will lead to better comparability of our statistics with the global world. That is one advantage, sir. But the final thing we have to study in more detail.
Okay, last question. You are from IIT Delhi. A lot of research in nanotechnology is happening in IIT Delhi. Yes. What is nano pollution and how do we control nano pollution?
Sir, nano pollution is the destruction or the degradation of the environment by particles which are nanometer in size, nanometer level scaled size. For example, sir, microplastics and nanoplastics that are being released in the ocean. That is a major challenge to our food web chain and the marine life. Sir, nanoparticles are also released as part of different particulate matter and soot particles also. So beyond that, I have limited understanding.
Okay. Thank you. Over to you. Thank you.
Hello, sir.
You see, recently, a lot of earthquakes have been happening in Delhi and places around. What is the reason behind that?
Sir, Delhi is located in a zone 4 or the second highest vulnerable zone as compared as evaluated in earthquake vulnerable zone in India. And sir, Delhi is also located near the Great Himalayan Tectonic Plate, the region where the Indian subcontinent plate meets the Eurasian plate. And therefore, sir, these are release of tensions regularly in the region. And as opposed to various experts who have pointed out that this is a pointer to a bigger earthquake coming in Delhi. So that is not the case because till now, nobody can predict when a big earthquake can occur in a region.
What do you know about central seismic cap?
Sir, I have limited recalling of that concept. Sir, seismic gaps are the time frame by during which we expect a major earthquake to happen, but they do not happen at that time. So there's a probability that the earthquake will happen soon. So if you know that the last two earthquakes happened at the duration of 30 years, and so a coming earthquake is pending. So that is a seismic gap. And through that, we can have certain predictions do not accurate about an incoming earthquake?
I can see that you have been living in Delhi for quite a long and you must be knowing that in Delhi, a large number of population lives in scattered settlements, that is in illegal settlements. And these people are particularly vulnerable to earthquakes because they live in those buildings which are not according to the earthquake norms. And as an administrator, suppose you are posted in Delhi and you are in the concerned department, what proactive measures can you take so that people do not lose their lives in the case of any forthcoming earthquake?
Sir, firstly, I would ensure that any new buildings or commercial establishments that are coming up, they subscribe to the building design codes that are given by the Bureau of Indian Standards for earthquake resistant buildings. So secondly, I would ensure that all the squattered settlements that that are there and unauthorized colonies that are there, they are redeveloped by various schemes such as in situ rehabilitation, or there is better redevelopment and better facilities there. Thirdly, sir, to ensure that the people are proactive and community participation is there, I would ensure that mock drills are there. People know about what to do in an earthquake, because redevelopment of the squatter settlements is a medium to long term plan. And in the short term, we have to ensure that people are aware what to do in an exigency.
All right. Rice is a Rabi crop or Kharif crop?
Sir, rice is a Kharif crop.
The father and mother, both of them belong to West Bengal. In West Bengal, is it Rabi or Kharif?
Sir, in West Bengal, since the water availability is very high and from the Ganga, and it is also near the coastal areas, so rice is one of the main staple crops and is grown for a long duration, sir. But I have limited knowledge of that.
That's so all season crop. Okay. You are from a prestigious institution, IIT Delhi. See, drug abuse has become a social menace in most of the big institutions these days. Was it a problem in your institution also?
Yes, sir. It was a problem, sir.
Okay. Suppose you are SP, superintendent of police, and you are like you have got this job to raid this college. Suppose that you have got this information by your informants that there are a lot of drug abuse in some college and you have to raid this college. What steps would you take and how will you deal with that problem during the raid?
Sir, my first point of action will be to communicate whatever information that I have about drug abuse to the college administration, because they are the ones who have disciplinary committees, of which I also have been a part of, to take actions against the erring students and to penalize them or to reform them in whatever manner, or to counsel them to change their habits. Secondly, sir, if I know about any organized networks which are supplying drugs to these institutes or the peddlers that are there outside the college gate, I'll crack down upon them using the intelligence that I have from the area. And sir, beyond that, I would also initiate a public awareness and the student awareness program in collaboration with the institute administration to tell students about the harms of drug abuse and what impact it can have in their long-term career and life.
My last question would be that why IITs are not among the top educational institutions of the world, despite of the fact that they have the most brilliant students among the world? There's no denial in the fact that IITs, the students who study in IITs, particularly like in BTech and Tech programs, they are among the brightest of the students of the world. But still, the IITs are not among the top educational institutes in the world. What are the reasons behind this fact? What do you think?
Yes. Sir, if we see the parameters on which the institutes are evaluated by these global rankings, such as QS or Shanghai Global Ranking, we see that IITs have been doing fairly well in the research output and in the citations per faculty. But sir, where we lag is the foreign faculty and the foreign students that are there in IITs. Secondly, sir, the student to teacher ratio is also not up to the 1:10 ideal levels. because of high vacancies in the college. And sir, also in certain infrastructural requirements also we lag a little bit behind the foreign university.
One last question, it's a very small question. Your father is engaged in which business?
Sir, he imports automobile spare parts and then he is a trader in Delhi region. Sir.
Okay. Then why don't you want to join his business? Why do you want to come to civil service? You are a B.Tech in from IIT Delhi. You can do wonders in business sector also.
So my inclination and decision to go into civil services was influenced by the leadership opportunities and the exposures I had in college. And they convinced me that it's not business or private sector or profit that is the primary motivator, but the passion to be in governance and to take initiatives for societal impact.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Over to you, sir.
Okay, Jayant. You are from West Bengal. What is this Gorkhaland issue and what is the appropriate solution to it?
So the Gorkhaland is a demand by the local people in the upper regions of West Bengal near the Darjeeling area to have an autonomous power in their area, and they are also demanding a separate state from West Bengal given their unique ethnic and the language that they have, the unique languages such as Nepali that they practice. And so the solution for this is not to accede to the secessionist demand or to have a separate state for them, but rather grant more autonomy and more powers to the Gorkhaland Autonomous Council so that people have more stakes in the governance of that area.
Okay, so is West Bengal a new Kashmir?
No, sir. I will beg to differ from that opinion, sir.
Okay. No issues. Your option subject is political science and international relations. Okay. India is having fishermen issues with Pakistan as well as with Sri Lanka and not with Bangladesh. So first question is why so? And second is the appropriate solution for it.
Sir, as far as the fishermen issue with Sri Lanka is concerned, it is about the marine disputes. For example, sir, for instance, we have gifted the Kachatibu Island to Sri Lanka, and now Sri Lanka doesn't allow our fishermen to conduct fishing activities there. And also they have issues in the bottom trawling that our fishermen are practicing there, which is harmful to the marine life there. Secondly, in the Pakistani area, we have had a long-standing dispute over the Sar Creek issue, and also they are contesting maritime zones. In Bangladesh, we don't have such a dispute because India has resolved both the land and the maritime dispute, and the arbitral panel of the international arbitral panel, we have signed off that and given the marine claims to Bangladesh.
Okay. Is China applying nutcracker doctrine to India?
Sir, I do not have specific understanding of the term nutcracker. But if that means that it is applying pressure on all sides.
Okay. Yes, exactly. Okay, no issues. Can you compare the new definitions of micro, small and medium enterprises vis-a-vis old ones?
So the new MSME classifications have been done based on the turnover levels. So a micro unit is an enterprise which has less than 5 crore of turnover. A small enterprise is one which has less than 50 crore of turnover. And a medium enterprise is one which has less than 250 crores of turnover.
Okay. So, yes, exactly. You are right. So, what is your take on this new MSME loan scheme to the small businessmen? So, is it actually being implemented? What are your views on it?
Sir, the 100% credit guarantee of rupees 3 lakh crore to the MSMEs that was given in the Atmanirbhar package. Sir, that is a very good scheme because it gives the confidence to the bank to loosen their purse strings and give MSMEs whichever MSMEs require it without any collaterals and with the credit backing of the government. Sir, but the offtakes have been low to the MSMEs, and we need to ensure that the banks and the MSMEs are more aware of the scheme, and the banks are more proactive in lending.
Okay, have your father applied for any of these loans?
No, sir. My father has not applied for any.
Okay. Okay. Have you gone through economic survey?
Yes, sir. I have gone through.
Okay. Economic survey talks about following Tamasic model of Singapore. Okay. Have you heard of it?
No, sir. I have.
Okay. No issues. Okay. Have you heard of the term Operation Twist?
Yes, sir. I have. Heard.
Okay. Yes. What is it?
Sir, Operation Twist is an monetary initiative by RBI in which it is selling the short tenor bonds and buying the long tenor government bonds, and from that it needs it wants to inject liquidity into the system.
Okay. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Two quick questions. What is a nano? How do you define nano when we talk of nanotechnology? In metric terms, how much is one nano equal to?
So 1 nanometer is 10^-9 meters.
Yeah, very good. It is said that human mind is not capable of extracting exact meaning of very large numbers. When I tell you 1 billion versus 100 billion versus billion, 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 your mind is not able to comprehend. Why? Why so? And same thing applies to very small numbers. We talk of 10^-9 or 10^-23. Why is our mind stopping and not comprehending very large or very small numbers? Any reason you can think?
So my understanding is that our brain has evolved through a complex evolutionary process. And in that evolution, humans have not interacted with anything beyond the visual range and things that we have not experienced. So anything that is very far below the observational limit or very high, which we have not experienced, then it becomes outside our memory range and experiential range.
Exactly. Wonderful. Very, very good reply. Very good reply. That is the reason why zero helped and only mathematics helps. Last question is on self-help books. Vipassana, of course, you are practicing Vipassana. So tell me which one self-help book has actually helped you in reaching up to this stage where you are going to appear before the board.
Sir, at the start of January in 2019, I read a book called Atomic Habits. It is by an author, James Clear. It was released at that time. And sir, it is a wonderful book. It has practical insights on how can we build good habits and how can we break bad habits. So sir, by practicing those insights, I have come to practice Vipassana daily. I have come to do regular physical exercises. And I have learned how to track my progress and to maintain the momentum that I have made, rather than just having spots of energy here and there.
Yeah, and it is said that 21-day period is sufficient period for changing the habit. Why 21 days? Why not 22 or 20? In the
study,
I think it must have been mentioned.
Yes, sir. Sir, even in the book, it mentioned that 21 days is just based on anecdotal evidence. There is no hard scientific logic behind 21 days. It can be 33 days for some people or 40 days. And sir, in my personal experience, what I've observed is even after 21 days, if you leave a habit for 5 days, you come again back to zero.
Yes, very much. Thank you. Thank you very much.